Julian Assange. And one thing I want to say to you today is, it is not only that he is the victim of torture, it is not only that his life is at stake, it is not only that we want to save him from a dreadful injustice, we also want to save him because the world needs Julian Assange as a symbol and fighter for liberty in these times.
Crusader, author, Assange's close friend, and my dear friend, Craig Murray, who I love so much because, you know what? He's in the school of, into the school of Diogenes. He doesn't believe in the written word. That speech, which took place back in 2019 in London at St. Pancras Church, was done off the top of his head. He walked into the church, looked at a few engravings there, and looked at the history of the church, and saw that it was funded by those who benefited from slavery and other nefarious activity. And they built the church to try to atone for their evil. He just like went up and ad-libbed the whole thing for 25, 30 minutes. And so that's the school of Diogenes. If you're into the school of Plato, then you write everything down and you read it, but you can always make amends to it. I actually believe in spontaneity. And I mean, Homer, you take a look at the Iliad and the Odyssey, that was verbal. He didn't write it down. All right. So there's something that you're that when you write it down and then rewrite it and then rewrite it, that it doesn't really come from the heart. Craig, I'm saying, subscribes to the idea of, you know, working off the top of his, and he does it brilliantly, as does George Galloway. You know, you don't see George Galloway reading a speech. You the problem is, if you read a speech that you've written, you could never do it with the kind of emotion. You know, if you're out in front of a lot of people, you're reading it. You're reading it, and so you don't know where to hit the high points, where, you know, instinctively, not even instinctively, viscerally, you hit the high points when you're doing it off the top of your head. But I don't want to talk about that too much. It's a hot day today, and I'm cranky because of the heat. All right, taking the subway, the dog is like half dead from this heat, and I'm alive. I'm alive because last night I had the greatest meal. Every couple of weeks, I go to Steve Brown's house. You know, I'm Italian-American, and growing up in an Italian-American family, we never went to restaurants, only ate at home, all right? I won't go unless somebody drags me to Little Italy, and you have that commercial stuff with Penny or Ziti. But Steve Brown's like one of the few, outside of Emily Kunzer's, whose Italian food I will eat. And he makes the rigatoni is perfect. My ancestors would be proud of the way he cooks a rigatoni. It just comes out perfectly. And we'll do a show on Steve Brown's rigatoni and bolognese sauce, which I don't even eat bolognese sauce except for his. And it's got the best Parmesan cheese as well. All right. Listen, well, you heard Craig Murray. Craig Murray, that is from the speech. And we're going to be not interviewing him. Like 10 days ago, I filled in for Linda Sarsour on a Wednesday, her show on Wednesday, because she was out of town. And I got Craig to do the show. And Kelly took a segment of that, or the whole thing, actually, of that interview. And we're going to play, you know, it depends on how long I talk to Ray McGovern here coming up. And that's who we're going to talk to, Ray McGovern, because since that interview with Craig Murray, a lot of stuff has happened. And I want to talk to Ray to fill us in on his thoughts on what has transpired. There are people criticizing me. I was in the Russian embassy 2 days ago when I was doing the Assange billboard truck in D.C. But I went to the embassy. And, you know, I spoke as an American to, you know, diplomats inside of the Russian embassy. I wish Tony Blinken and I wish Joe Biden and everybody else would talk to them. I'm going to talk to them. If you want to arrest me for doing it, go ahead. But I'm engaged in a dialogue because I represent the majority of the American people who don't want to be involved in another conflict. If you take a look at the last 100 years and beyond of Americans' involvement anywhere in the world, whatever side we were on, with the exception of World War II, and that's even debatable, the motivation for getting in, we've never been on the right side. So why would this time, this particular time, supporting Ukrainians, why would that be the one instance in the history of the U.S. foreign policy? Would it be the right instance? Ukrainians I spoke to oppose the Kiev government. I've got a lot of energy today because I had some of Bernadette Evangelist's coffee this morning. Let's go to the music for Ray McGovern. This is Johnny Rivers, and we'll be back with the great Ray McGovern.
There's a man who leads a life of danger. To everyone he meets, he stays a stranger. With every move he makes, another chance he takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man. They've given you a number and taken away your name. Beware of pretty faces that you find. Pretty face can hide an evil mind. Be careful what you say, or you give yourself away. Odds are you won't live to see tomorrow. Secret Asian man, secret Asian man. They've given you a number and taken away.
Former secret agent man, Ray McGovern, joining us from Langley, Virginia. No, I'm kidding. He's coming from Raleigh, North Carolina. And Ray, it's always a pleasure to have you on this show, giving us your very, you know, very, very bright insight on what's happening around the world. And did you hear my little rant there about when has the U.S., with the exception of World War II, for whatever reason, been on the right side of a conflict?
I did hear that, Randy. And of course, you're talking about the elite folks who run the U.S. and U.S. foreign policy. And no one believes, I hope, that you're talking about the normal American, but the decent person just trying to get along and have a good life. But these elite folks are getting us into a peck of trouble.
Yeah. All right. So, but I'm looking back, if you go back to the Philippines, the Spanish, the Spanish-American War, whether it be in Cuba or in Philippines, going through occupying Nicaragua, World War One, which we got in late, and they arrested anyone that opposed that war, and just all the way up to Vietnam or any of the coups in the 50s. I'm just trying to Iraq. In 2003 and then in 1999, I'm just trying to think of a conflict where we chose a side that it was on. It was the right side and the good side. I mean, the moral side.
Well, I was alive for that entire war, and that's called World War II. And the supreme irony is that we and the Russians cooperated. Without us, the Russians probably would have won, but it would have taken two or three more years. Without the Russians, no one would have won except for a fellow named Adolf Hitler.
Wow, that's so actually the best. I got to write that down, Ray. I haven't heard it like that. You've never said that to me on this show. But that's, all right, go ahead, Ray. It's good.
Well, let me just backtrack here and say that I'm delighted to play warm-up band for Craig Murray.
He may not get on because you and I may get on a long riff here. Go ahead.
That's all right. But I just want to say that Greg is one of my friends as well. You know, you try every now and then to lift the tone of this broadcast, Randy. I know that you're a vulture for culture, is what we used to say up in the Bronx there. So I'm going to start out with something you mentioned about people not writing things down, but memorizing them. And here it goes. It applies to Craig Murray, to you, and to others. Here it is. Andromoi enapamusa polutrapan hos malapala plankte epe troyes hierantem epersa. First two lines of Homer's Odyssey.
Wow.
What does it say? It says, tell me, O muse, of a really well-rounded, would have said Renaissance, but the Renaissance didn't happen yet, right? A well-rounded Renaissance man who has suffered a lot. Tell me about that man. Now, in those days, it was Odysseus or Ulysses, okay? Today, it's people like Craig Murray. Have they suffered a lot? Oh, you know, he's in prison for what, 6-7 months?
Yep.
For nothing, right?
Right.
And so these people are standing up despite all the difficulties in their path. And, you know, I have to tell you that not only you know, we are people of modest means, but we give a monthly contribution to Craig Murray's website. And it's the proudest thing I do because I want to support Craig in all he does, and not only his speeches, but his active and courageous defense of people like Julian Assange. So a word to the wise. Craig would never say this, and Randy, you wouldn't either, but go to his website, donate, make sure
I always tell
survives.
People, I bring it up in this interview, okay? But okay. I don't bring up my website because I'm no good at raising money. You know, other people do it for me. I'm squeamish at asking for money. But your organization has supported the Assange Countdown to Freedom, you know, its project in D.C. Multiple occasions. But, you know, today, 100%, and you've actually taken some of our billboards and you paid for them personally in Raleigh, North Carolina. Which I appreciate.
You're most welcome. I mean, what else could you spend your money on, you know? I mean,
you could subscribe to MSNBC and CNN on a monthly basis and pay $200 and disinform yourself. That's like getting a jab of disinformation. You want to talk about the jab and people talking about the vaccine? Well, you know, that's what that is. That doesn't vaccinate you from disinformation. It actually corrupts you with disinformation by subscribing to MSNBC, CNN, Fox, whatever, all of those programs. Unless you watch Queen for the Day for a Day or Bowling for Dollars or The Dating Game or Wheel of Fortune, you can actually get more information politically from those types of programs than you do from these so-called news outlets called MSNBC,
well, Randy,
CNN.
There's no danger at all that I would be investing any money or paying any money to outlets like that.
Well, you got to. You have to have. You must have cable, so you're paying a percentage of that cable to whoever owns CNN right now. I guess Robert Malone.
I suppose, yeah. But you know, somebody asked me here, Ray. I'll sponsor you. Please join the Raleigh Country Club. You can play golf with us. And, you know, I had to tell you, Randy. I spent my summers starting at age 14 through age 23. Caddying on golf courses, and my Irish grandmother warned me before I went ever out there, and she said, now Raymond, you're going to be working with the upper crust. You need to know what the upper crust is. I said, oh, yeah, I know. She don't know. Now sit you down, and I'll tell you. And she says, the upper crust is a bunch of crumbs held together by a lot of dough.
Well, listen, but that actually is probably a good experience. That's why you're in such good shape, Ray, because you walked the links for 36 holes, and it's good exercise. Was John McCloy on any of those golf trips that you were on?
Well, I'll tell you, the people I caddied for, people like Henry Ford, one trip, who is the head of Pan American, all these folks, you know, and I really was inoculated by that grandmother that I just quoted against falling into the mode of thinking these people were better than I was. They still think they're better than I am, but I no longer think so, and thereon hangs a tale. Now, Randy, I'd like to talk a little about Iraq and the rest of what's happened here, and now Ukraine.
All right, we'll go right ahead. Yeah, I got 40 seconds left. No, I'm kidding, Ray. Go ahead.
Well, you know, I was thinking back. People asked me right after the attack on Iraq, against which we had warned, we veteran intelligence professionals, for sanity. We said, you know, this would be crazy. And Mr. Bush, if you do this, the unintended consequences are likely to be catastrophic. And that was the way we finished up our first memo to him, written in the afternoon after Colin Powell spoke. So our record is pretty good. But right after the attack, people ask me, well, why'd they do it? Why'd they do it? Why'd they lie? Why'd they say the weapons of mass destruction? Why did they hint that Saddam Hussein was in part responsible for 9/11, for God's sake, because he had ties with al-Qaeda? Why'd they do that? And so I came up with a little acronym. It was O-I-L, okay? Now,
yeah.
O for oil, I for Israel, L for logistics. We wanted permanent military bases in Iraq. We didn't get them. Okay, now, John Stewart really reamed me out for that. He says, McGovern, you're violating the rules for acronyms. You can't have O and then oil. It doesn't. So that's beside the point. What I'm trying to say is now I have three things that explain why Putin went into Ukraine. Okay, the first thing is...
Wait a second, you say Putin. What,
yeah.
I mean, you mean the Russia Federation went in. I mean, it's not his decision alone. I mean,
that's
you know,
correct.
You can
yeah,
say that George Bush alone went into Iraq and Afghanistan. He didn't do it alone. There are other people involved. Mm-hmm. So there's a Duma or whatever the legislature is called right now that and other advisors... people in the upper crust of the cabinet that would say, all right, let's do this. No one's going to do it on their own.
Well, Randy, you're right about that. But you have to concede that Vladimir Putin is primus inter pares. He's the first among equals. He's the widely acknowledged head of his country, and people respect him, and he's got a 70% approval rate, for God's sake.
Well, if you take a look at that country, if you take a look at Moscow and see how clean that city is and how magnificent it is and how beautiful and majestic it is and how busy it is, it wasn't like that when Yeltsin was there. So people are very happy with the accomplishments that he's made in improving and bringing back this country from its doldrums into where it is right now, which is a, you know, it's up there at the very top.
Well, I know, Randy. I was there in 72 and again several times starting 10 years ago. So I know that. And be aware, I'm not suggesting that Putin gets out and cleans the streets in the early morning. At least he's got a lot of help, all right? But when I say Putin, that's a shorthand for the Russian government decided to go into Ukraine. Now the question is why? Answer number one, there are three answers. The first one was that the Ukrainian armed forces had been trained up in the previous 7 years to NATO standards with NATO weaponry. They were the strongest army in Europe, and they were about to pounce on the Donbas, where Russian-speaking citizens live, Donetsk and Lugansk. And that was clear even to the OSCD, the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe. They reported it. The Western press didn't report it. Putin and his associates knew about it. And so that was reason number one, a preemptive sort of thing to prevent that from happening, because once they take over, once the Ukrainians sort of flagship of the Nazis there, the neo-Nazis who are running parts of that army, Azov Battalion, for example.
Terrorist organization.
Donbass,
right.
Yeah, then it would be, you know, that would be really hard. So anyway, preemptive move, number one, preventive move, number one. Now, number two, the U.S. had been building bases for missiles in Romania and in Poland. They're in there now. Question is, what's in those capsules? Those capsules can into which can fit cruise missiles and eventually hypersonic missiles. What has Putin personally said about that? He told his assembled military, all the admirals and generals that were available on December 21, 2021, he told them, look, cruise missiles can reach us in about 7 to 10 minutes in Moscow, and if they put hypersonic missiles in, it's going to be 5 minutes. That's not going to happen, okay? Where are these installations? Already there in Romania and already there in Poland. What Putin wanted to make sure they didn't go into Ukraine. And hear this now, audience. He got a promise. He got an assurance from the President of the United States on the 30th of December, 2021, saying, Biden, quote, the U.S. has no intention of deploying offensive strike missiles in Ukraine. Whoa, that was a biggie. There was great rejoicing in Moscow on the next day, New Year's Eve, and following. Then the negotiations started 9 days later, and guess what happened? The U.S. forgot about it. Somebody whispered into Joe Biden, no, you can't do that. And so they forgot about it. And that was one reason where Putin said, well, you know, I've been diddled enough. The Minsk Accords and now this, they tell me, and now they won't even talk about this assurance that Biden gave me personally on the telephone on the 30th of December. So these offensive strike missiles are the same kind of danger to Russia that the medium-range ballistic missiles that Khrushchev put in Cuba in 1962, we know how JFK, to our blessing, reacted to that. You know how close we came to nuclear war. Khrushchev backed off. Why? Because it was not an existential threat to the Soviet Union. It was an existential threat to Kennedy. And what did he do? He violated the law. He put in a blockade. You're not supposed to do that. He threatened nuclear war. That's what we'll do that. He had a party ready to invade Cuba and displace Castro. You're not supposed to do that either. Now, what I'm saying is there's a direct analogy here. When a major nuclear power feels threatened in an existential way, it's going to do what it feels it needs to do to protect itself. And so that's reason number two. That's why Putin thought it necessary to go into the Donbass and started the attack on the 24th of February last year. Third reason, China. McGovern, why you mentioned China about it? China. Okay, on February 4th, Putin was up there in Beijing to help Xi Jinping open the Winter Olympics. They issued a statement which said, there's no limit to our cooperation. And this is clear in retrospect. I didn't know it at the time, but this is the way it went, according to my interpretation. Putin, good friend Xi, I have to tell you about Ukraine. I'm being diddled again. They're about to attack our people there in the Donbass. And they have these medium-range missiles circling us. And I think I'm going to have to go in there and clean them out, demilitarize and denazify them. What do you think, Xi Jinping? You mean after the Winter Olympics are over, right? Yeah, that's what I meant. Now, Why is that so surprising? That violates the cardinal principle of Chinese foreign policy, the Treaty of Westphalia. You don't violate other people's borders. You don't invade other people's countries. Putin got a waiver from Xi Jinping. It's clear. It's clear. And what happened was even the rhetoric on the Chinese side changed. How? Well, they didn't stress Westphalia for the next 3 months. No, what they said was, you know, we judge things like the invasion of Ukraine on its own merits. When core interests are violated by from a big power, you've got to expect this kind of thing. So what I'm saying here is that I don't think Putin would have gone into Ukraine if he hadn't gotten previous assurance from Xi Jinping that he would have his back. And now, of course, we see them closer than ever, with the Chinese defense minister just being in Moscow, signing all kinds of new accords just 3 weeks ago. So all I'm saying here is that you can see three reasons why Putin and his associates decided to go in there. Now, let me just add one thing, okay?
I do, because I have some questions for you at the expense of Craig Murray's appearance on this show.
Okay, all right. Just a second here.
I'm going to tell Craig Murray you're responsible for him being, axed out.
That's okay. I'll have to buy
it. It'll be on our website. The complete Craig Murray interview Kelly Lane is putting together. That will be on our website from last week's show with him if we don't really get too much of him during this show. Go ahead.
Okay. All right. So, I gave a major talk. It was for Boston Community Church in Massachusetts.
I'm doing that this Sunday, by the way.
Oh,
I'm going
good.
To that
okay.
church on Sunday
That's
to
right.
Deliver a speech.
I saw that. Yeah, Dean has his head screwed on.
He
right.
does. That's Dean's the best.
Yeah, he's the pastor or the regulator or whatever. Anyhow, I spoke up under their auspices. It was Zoom. They had 400 people sign up before because I advertised it as not a situation report on Ukraine, but as an example of the kind of analysis that we used to do in the Central Intelligence Agency with access to all manner of experts, you know, physicists, whatever you needed, military experts, you'd have them, okay? And so what I did was I asked Ted Postol, who knows more about intermediate-range nuclear missiles and ICBMs than anybody else I know, and who used to serve as the chief advisor to the chief of naval operations in the Pentagon, and, of course, is professor emeritus at MIT. So he and I worked maybe four nights together, several hours. I said, what about this, Ted? What about this? What we addressed were these intermediate-range nuclear missiles in Romania and Poland. We did a map, and we showed how quickly they could reach Moscow, okay? I told you before, Putin said 5 minutes if it's hypersonic. Well, that's what it turns out to be. We showed where the sites were in Poland and Romania and how quickly it could come from Kiev if these things were in Ukraine. So what's the point of my remarks? Well, I put out all this information, combining what Putin himself had said, and then saying, well, now, Ted, is that right? I mean, is he just blowing smoke? And Ted would give me another graphic showing, well, actually, no, Ray, look at these sites. The worst is that we could see the signature in Cuba of these medium-range ballistic missiles. The Russians can't be sure what's in those capsules in Romania and in Poland, okay? They can't be sure what's there because there's no signature. They're just closed-up little pillboxes they look like. Anyhow, at the end of this whole thing, with me being very, very factual, like just the facts, ma'am, and Ted as backup with all these wonderful graphics, there was a comment in the chat that said, wow, why is McGovern justifying the attack on Ukraine? Now, here's the point. a very, very well-respected psychiatrist wrote back.
Dr. Hackenbush.
No, not him. They're a really good guy. He's in retirement now, but he writes to me and he says, Ray, isn't this interesting? You didn't say a word about justifying. You just laid out the facts. And he says, you were justifying. So, Ray, let's parse this. So the facts said to him that the invasion was justified. You didn't say it. The facts said it.
I understand. I understand that. That's what what I determined when I was there, and I was in the Donbass region, and I was in Donetsk, and there were HIMAR missiles. I'm scared blankless the whole time I'm there for 6 days, driving around in an armored vehicle to Mariupol and to Saramagia on a dirt road in an armored vehicle. And while I was there, you had a open air market bombed, and then bombed 10 minutes later when the emergency crew showed up. Same thing at a university there. And then when I left, they had hit on Easter Sunday for the Orthodox Church of Russia. They had hit in Donetsk that and killed 9 people. And then they killed the other day after I got back a bunch of school children with the same kind of MO, which is to hit civilian targets. Now, what are they supposed to do, Ray?
Well, Randy, I trust you. And I ask you, why did this not appear in the New York Times or the Washington Post?
Because they weren't there. They were out looking for the blueprints of missile systems from the Wall Street Journal in eastern Russia, right, rather than being in western Russia, which would be Donetsk, which is the Donetsk People's Republic. They weren't there and
right,
reporting on it. They were looking to expose weaknesses in the Russian economy, and to look at these various military industrial sites.
Sure.
And
well,
find
there are
out
two reasons.
Why weren't they
Randy
there with me? Why weren't there? Why wasn't Michael Isikoff there with me instead of criticizing me?
Two reasons. They might get blown up. And number two, they might find out the truth, and it'd be really hard to write a story around.
Well, I was worried about being blown up when I was there. I couldn't find a place where I felt safe when I was there because they were only hitting civilian targets in Donetsk. These are Ukrainian forces. I don't know if they're Azov or whatever, but they only hit military targets. Why would they do that? The only reason why I can figure out why they would do that is to strike fear and know that there would be no repercussions from the Western press.
You know, Randy, you're saying they struck civilian targets, right?
That's all they did the whole time I was there. That's why when I was in a Russian restaurant, three-story Russian restaurant in Donetsk, I was trying to find a place that would be safe if it were hit by a HIMAR made by Lockheed. I'm thinking, where do I go here? There was no place to go. And when I did George Galloway's show, there was no place to go in my hotel room because that hotel had already been hit. So I'm not a war correspondent.
Right.
You know,
so Randy, what's the teaching point here, if I can interrupt, is simply
no,
this.
No, please do. I'm talking too much.
I'm saying that one of those reasons I gave for the invasion of to explain, not to justify, to explain why Putin did what he did, was that before Russia invaded Ukraine, 14,000 Ukrainian civilians of Russian stock, so Russian
were killed where I was.
Were killed. Okay.
Where I
killed,
was. Right? Where I was.
Yeah. Where you went, right. Now, since the invasion, 4,000 to 5,000 more. Now, these are civilians. This is the town hall These are the playgrounds, you know. We talk about the Russians doing this, but there's no real evidence that the Russians have been targeting shopping malls or anything like that. You know, if there's a defense industry right next to the shopping mall, there might be a little debris they got on that shopping mall. But interesting, nobody gets killed or very few. So all I'm saying is this key reason, I listed it first, didn't I, as to why the invasion happened was that the Ukrainian forces were prepared to go into this area of Ukraine, clean out all those Russians that were resisting the regime in Kiev, but had agreed to have a regional autonomy under the Minsk Accords. The Minsk Accords, we know, were where Putin was diddled. Now, when I say, you know what diddled means because you're from New York, right?
Okay. I'm diddly squat, yes.
Yeah, okay. Well, not Bo Diddley, but, you know, diddle. What happened was, you know, after the coup that we arranged, or we helped to arrange in Kiev, the Ukrainian army, such as it was, went out to
wait,
the
wait
east.
A second. That we helped or, I mean, directly arranged? I mean, really,
well,
you can't soften that and say that we helped to arrange it.
Well,
it was definitely
okay.
coming
All
from
right.
D.C.
Yeah, the evidence from that conversation alone shows that we were orchestrating who took over the country. That's clear. It was the most blatant coup in history. So what I'm saying is the Ukrainian army, such as it was, and it wasn't much then, we're talking 2014, goes out to the east because the people in Donetsk and Lugansk, they don't like the idea of their Russian language, their primary language, being banned as an official language. They don't like the idea of having these coup people come in and oppress them, and so they're resisting. Okay, there's firefights. There's a war going on, and nobody is winning. And finally, people came to their senses and said, let's talk about this. And then you had the Minsk Accords, okay? The key to the Minsk Accords was Ukraine's promise and the other people guaranteeing that there would be a regional autonomy granted to Donetsk and Lugansk, and that would be written into a new Ukrainian constitution. Never happened. Never happened for 7 years. Now we know from Angela Merkel, the head of Germany, from François Hollande, the head of France at the time, from Poroshenko himself, the head of Ukraine at the time, and, of course, now by Zelensky. Oh, you know, we just wanted to buy some time so that we could get the Ukrainian forces trained up to NATO standards and get all the equipment so that we could have, you know, hello? There's no apology there. They brag about it. We diddled Putin. What does Putin say? All right, folks, I recognize I was diddled, okay? We should have gone on and protected those people that Donetsk and Lugansk when they asked us to in 2014. Okay, I'm sorry about that. You have it right. I delayed too long. I ain't going to let that happen again. Nobody's going to diddle me anymore.
But he was totally hornswoggled.
He was. And the idea that he admits it so candidly and still has a 70% approval rate, my God. The guy, I have to tell you, that we are extremely fortunate that somebody so restrained and so perspicacious in seeking to defend his country, which, after all, is the first task of a president, we are lucky to have him rather than some crazy person in power in the Kremlin. And I would just add this. I mentioned the word crazy. Well, you know, when Putin was asked in October of last year, he said, you know, how do you explain America's desire to take on China at the same time as they're taking us on in Ukraine? Well, what do you think's going on there? And Putin said, you know, I looked at that. I don't see any logic. You know, at first I thought there might be some subtle, but no, they're crazy. This can only be explained by arrogance and a feeling of impunity, period, end quote. Now, I happen to agree with that, but it doesn't matter what McGovern thinks, for God's sake, it does matter what Vladimir Putin thinks and what his generals think. If these guys are crazy, you know, if they think that that, for example, Blinken got the British to promise to bring missiles in with a range of 150 miles.
Wait a second, Ray. I want to talk to you about that when we. I have to take a break here, and I'm going to take a break here and into that. That was the original reason why I asked you to do this show today, was talk about those recent developments. And Craig Murray will be here on this show next Friday. We're going to play that entire interview next Friday. So we've decided live on the fly to morph it into a Ray McGovern interview. I'm going to come right back, Ray. We're going to have about 7 minutes left. But I gotta take a breather here, and we'll be right back with Ray McGovern. And this music here is really germane to the conversation that we're having.
The Eastern world, it is exploding, violence flaring, bullets loading. You're old enough to kill, but not for voting. You don't believe in war, but what's that gun you're toting? And even the Jordan River has bodies floating. But you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, you don't believe we're on the eve of destruction. Don't you understand what I'm trying to say? Can't you feel the fears I'm feeling today? If the button is pushed, there's no running away. There'll be no one to save with the world in a grave. Take a look around you, boy. It's bound to scare you, boy. And you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, you don't.
I'm Randy Credico, Randy Credico, live on the fly. Ray, welcome welcome back to the last 10 minutes of this show.
Thanks.
Are we on the eve of destruction, Ray?
Yeah, I wish you hadn't asked that question, but, you know, I've been around for a long time, Randy. I started with the
CIA. What are you, 75 years old?
No, older. I'm older than what's his name, Biden. So
he's 200. No, he I'm looks 200 on, years older. I wish well, you were in old, his position. But... I wish you were there rather than Joe Biden.
Well, listen, I just want to.
That means you're smarter than the president of the United States and more cognizant.
Well, by his standards, didn't he say recently that? He gets wiser every year. He gets wiser. Well, you know, I think maybe that's true of me, but I also recognize my limitations. And here's the deal. The denouement is coming in about 1 month.
Yeah, what is a denouement? That's a French word. That means to finish. Tipping,
that's the end, The whole culmination of this drama. And that will be because the Ukrainians will realize that they're out of ammunition, they're out of people. The promised Western support has not arrived soon enough, and the Russians have the option of going all the way west to the Dnieper River, which is the natural divide between West and East Ukraine. At that time, it'll be time to deal. Now... everyone recognizes that. The Chinese, the Pope, for God's sake, the Belarusians, the Brazil president, they all say, look, for God's sake, it's time to have a ceasefire and negotiations. All except Blinken. Blinken and Nod and that other guy, Jacob Sullivan, okay? So what do? They get the British. You put in these big missiles, that's a red line for Russia. You do it. And so the British say, oh, sure, we do that. You put in the depleted uranium. Depleted uranium on those shells. We know what happens. Birth defects and everything else in the former Yugoslavia, of course, in Fallujah, in Iraq. It's unconscionable that people would poison the soil of Ukraine. Now, if Zelensky lets that happen, he cares less about the Ukrainian people than Putin certainly does. I mean, God. So anyhow, that's what the British are going to do. And worst of all, the British have said nonchalantly, this is Liz Truss when she was the prime minister. She says, you know, I quote, I'm quite ready to use nuclear weapons, even though this might mean a world war or the destruction of the planet. I'm quite ready to do that. It was only after she said that Putin said, you know, we have nuclear weapons too. Don't forget that, please. And we're going to put them on a higher alert. Now, he actually never did that, as far as we can discern. But the reminder was there. And if the British carry our water here and make these provocative things like depleted uranium and like these 150-mile range missiles going into Ukraine, there's going to be real trouble, because that's the exact opposite of what's needed now.
Why are they doing it, Ray? Why are the British doing this?
Because, well, the British just do whatever they're told by Blinken. The reason is, and this sounds simplistic, but they're crazy. They're well-heeled elite people who think we can work our will on anyone. They can't get it between their ears that with China and Russia against us, we can't possibly prevail in Ukraine or anywhere else that's significant. So they're crazy. And when I say that Putin thinks they're crazy, I'll say this matters, okay?
We got 40 seconds left, Ray.
What is this last-ditch effort, you know? It's crazy. It really is. So what will the Russians do? They'll go to the Dnieper and they'll say, okay, last chance, you're going to negotiate now. And then I hope, that Blinken and Sullivan will get their heads together and say, all right, well, we gave the Ukrainians everything they wanted, all 98% of what they wanted, and they couldn't do it. Okay, we'll negotiate. That's how cynical these guys are.
Well, we've been talking to Ray McGovern, who is a former CIA official, also the founder of the Sam Adams, Sam Adams Association, veteran intelligence professionals for sanity, and just an all-around good guy. Ray, you know, Craig got clipped off by you. I want you to know that he's going to be on next Friday. And you've enlightened. I got to play the whole thing, and mm-hmm. I'm going to be out of the country this week. I'm not going to tell people where I am, but I'm going to be out of the country. But I really appreciate your insight and affording us this time to really, as usual, shine some light on what's happening in the world. I'm going to let you go, Ray. Ray McGovern, thank you very much. What's your website, Ray?
RayMcGovern.com.
All right. That's it.
One, two, three, four. Ferry from Miami, bitch, me away, see. Didn't get to bed last night. On the way to Dapper, back was home on me. Man, I had a dreadful flight. Tom back in the U.S. is all.
The US is all.